you go, lifting my load again.
Carries me through all the Cause I dwell up here where the air is clear, where the light is bright and there's no more fear. I know my place, I know my name, I know you've called me to do great things. As I dwell up here where the air is clear, where the light is bright and there's no more fear. I know my place, I know my name, I know you've called me to do great things. As I dwell up here where the air is clear, where the light is bright and there's no more fear. I know my place, I know my name, I know you've called me to do great things. As I dwell
on the sun and the moon, like horses driven by kings. You cover the mountains, the valleys below, with the breath of your mighty wings.
Oh, treasures of wisdom and things to be known are hidden inside your hands. And in fortunate turn of events, you asked me to be your friend. Ask me to be your friend. And you are my first, you are my last, you are my future.
Are swimming inside the breath of your desire. So where could I run? Where could I hide from your heart's jealous fire?
Oh, treasures of wisdom and things to be known are hidden inside your hand. In this fortunate turn of events, you've asked me to be your friend. Ask me to be your friend.
But he brought me in, oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free. Who is free. Good morning, friends. It is so good to be with you. And what a week it has been. We are just 9 days into this new year, and already it seems apparent that 2022 is going to at least be notable. With a continual shifting landscape of COVID-19, we are, as you know, pausing our in-person services for this Sunday and next Sunday, with hopes of resuming January 23rd. So we'll be in conversation the closer we get to that date about that. But I know that this news, even for today and next week, can stir in us a myriad of feelings. So I just want to remind myself and us that we are here together, that we are not alone in this, and that the Spirit of God is also holding us. And I think this Spirit is fierce in seeking to shrink this sense of distance, whether it's through screen or by miles. So I invite you this morning into this truth, the truth and the beauty and the gift of this community, the beauty of the love and the experience of God's love. And maybe we'll find ourselves with our spirits lifted just a little bit and a sense of joy in our living as we do. Thank you for not giving up on meeting together and for claiming this virtual space as not only meaningful, but sacred, and for showing up just as you are. I hope that you are warm this morning, that you're comfortable. Maybe you have a warm cup of something in your hands. And I hope that the message translates from this Reservoir community, that you are welcomed and that you are loved without exception. So this morning, I invite you to lean in a little bit, yes, in spirit, but also physically. Get a little closer to your screens, maybe your keyboards. In this service, as is usual, we're going to invite you at different points to add in the chat your own voice into this communal space. Also to get a little close to be able to grab some links and some forms that will have some information for you that we think will be important. It will be interspersed kind of throughout the service today. So I'd love for you to be close enough to kind of get that in real time. And why don't we start now? I'd love for you to get a little close, chat in where you're calling from, your town, state, whatever room you might be in, and just say hi, let us know that you're here. And I'll read some as we go along. If we haven't met, I'm Ivy. I'm part of the staff team here, and I am grateful to be here with you. Welcome to Reservoir. So in terms of flow for this morning, I will start with a few announcements, and then we'll join Katie in song, and then Steve will be up with a message for today and a spiritual practice. I'll pop back on for a couple of communal events in prayer and also communion. So if you want to grab some elements to partake in that, something to eat, something to drink, you're welcome to do that now. And then we'll join Katie in song again, and Steve will close us out with the benediction. Hi, folks coming in from all over. John from Lincoln, Mass. Manny and Lynn from their living room with a cup of coffee. Becky at home in Marlborough, visiting from their living room, Mike and Debbie in Newton, Lisa from Brookline, so many of you calling in from your living rooms. Crystal from New Hampshire, kitchen counter, good to be with you this morning. Roger and Claire from Dorchester, Lydia from Arlington, so many of you, so great to see all of you and be with all of you here this morning. Desta from JP in Jammies, eating eggs and bacon. We can all head over to JP after this. Good to be with all of you guys. Okay, I'm gonna move to announcements now. The first of which is if you're new or you're looking to be a little more connected, we'd love for you to fill out this form that's going in the chat now. It just gives us a way to A, know that you're new and also to just have a conversation. A pastor will get back to you within the week. If you have any questions at all, or if you're just longing to maybe be in a community group, which you'll hear a little bit more of in just a minute, you can let us know all of those things through this form. So grab it, fill it out while you can. Secondly, we are switching to YouTube. We'll be holding our online services live on YouTube starting next week. So if you subscribe to our YouTube channel, search Cambridge Reservoir Church. It will be much easier to find us on a Sunday morning. And the link for that to get you there is going in the chat as well. We're super excited to begin live streaming for so many reasons. It has all of these great features that we have currently on Zoom webinar, such as chat, but it will also let us be able to reach so many more people that might be interested in an online community like this. It's more shareable, it's more accessible. So we're super excited to be making that move. The only caveat to not moving next week to YouTube Live is if one of us that's in the studio together gets COVID. But we will communicate in advance of that if that's the case. So have no fear. lastly, I'd love to talk a little bit about our community groups. So if you've been around Reservoir for a little bit, you've liked what you've heard in terms of vibe, our values, community groups is a great way to extend that into your week and into your experience with a smaller setting and more people that you can build relationships with. We have about 30 groups that meet throughout Greater Boston, a lot of them virtually now, given our landscape, but there's likely one that fits what you are looking for, your particular parameters. And it's a great way, again, to just connect, have a sense of belonging, experience the love of God, and really deepen your relationship, I think, with yourself, with others, and with God. So we're taking this front of the new year to kind of spotlight those, to give you a chance, if you've been thinking about it, to maybe start your new year off joining a group. But I wanted to let people that are in our community groups kind of have voice to what their experience has been. So we're actually gonna have two folks come on who are talking a little bit about the value of community groups as they've been in them over the years, why they prioritize them. So you'll hear from Charlie Martin and Taylor Yates, and then I'll come back on and let you know how to look up some of our community groups that we have.
Hi, my name is Charlie. My pronouns are they, them, theirs. And I have been a member of Reservoir Church for several years now. I joined my very first community group several years ago, and I remember feeling really nervous about it, not knowing what to expect, not knowing if I would fit in. As a trans person who has no connection with their biological family, it was really important to me, the concept of chosen family. So when I joined the small group that I'm in now, I was nervous, but I have found incredible, lifelong, meaningful relationships. I have met people who have made my successes important to them. I have met people who have cried with me when I needed to. I have met people who have fed me and put shoes on my feet and helped me through some of the hardest things I've ever had to go through. And we're also along for the ride in the good parts and the joys of life. Now more than ever, especially with COVID and its resurgence, we can start to feel really isolated. I know professionally for me, my job is to listen to people talk all day long. That's what I do. But sometimes you need to go somewhere where you can talk and where your story can get heard, and where you can cry if you need to, or laugh about something, or, you know, send an email and say, hey, I need prayer for this, or hey, can you keep this in mind for the next week? And that's what you'll find in these community groups. There's so many at Reservoir, so I really encourage people right now, if you're feeling disconnected, to reach out. I mean, it may feel a little awkward at first, but I have not once met somebody who hasn't been warm and welcoming, funny, charming, sweet, compassionate, loving. It's definitely really important right now to have a community connection when so many of us are moving to virtual formats or moving towards remote formats again. There's a lot up in the air right now with COVID, but the community groups that I'm a member of have given me solace in times of greatest need and greatest despair. So if you're considering a community group, try it out. Take it from me, it's definitely worth it.
Hi, my name is Taylor Yates. I've been a member of Reservoir Community Groups for a number of years now. I love community groups because I truly believe that relationships with others are one of the most important ways that we follow Jesus. You know, loving others, being loved back, sharing each other's trials, our tribulations, and our triumphs, that was an important part of Jesus' ministry, and it's one of the most enjoyable ways that we follow him. And, you know, especially during the pandemic, it has been the way that I have maintained friendships and a sense of community. And I encourage people to find that community through our groups.
So if relationships, a sense of belonging, extending love and being loved sounds notable, it might be a nice way to counter the vibe that we're entering into 2022 with, and to check out a community group. I think the link in the chat already went up for our community group booklet, but you can look through that pretty quickly. It's digitally kind of like a flip book, so you can flip through that. It's organized by day to see if you might be interested. If it sounds notable, but also compelling for you to join a community group, we certainly encourage you to do. I can make some recommendations for you if you want to email me, ivy@reservoirchurch.org. I can put you in contact and make an introduction to these awesome community group leaders, and we can get moving in that direction. So again, if you're interested in community groups, certainly reach out. Love to have you. Let me pray for us before we turn it over to Katie. Our steady, loving God, thank you for your presence here this morning. May it be notable. May it wake us up to the beauty and the goodness of this moment. May your presence inspire our hearts to stretch and to hold more of your love, more capacity to receive the abundance of your love and to give it out. God, revive on us the parts that are so tired or frustrated or numb. And in the most unhurried manner, could you lean into us this morning as much as we lean into you? Amen. I'll pass it over to Katie and invite you to worship.
Thanks, Ivy. Good morning, everyone. Just invite you to join me in our opening song this morning, in whatever space you are in or need to get in to enter into this time together. And see the words up on the screen and join me however you'd like.
I
you, Steve.
Hey, friends. I'm Steve. Good to be with you. Happy New Year. Hope you've had a safe and happy and healthy first week of the new year. If so, you are doing great and give yourself a pat on the back, a little hug or something. If not, totally here for you as well. So appreciate Katie leading us in song. I think I want to also lead us in just a snippet of a song that I've been singing every day the past week and a half. It's an old gospel song. It goes like this. You can use it everywhere you go. It goes, hold on just a little while longer. Hold on just a little while longer. Hold on just a little while longer. Everything will be all right. One more time. Hold on just a little while longer. Hold on just a little while longer. Hold on just a little while longer. Everything will be all right. Everything will be all right. I love that song. Great thing about that song, you don't just have to say, hold on. You can say, walk on. You can say, changing this diaper just a little while longer. Dealing with the spreadsheet a little while longer. Rapid testing a little while longer. Whatever it is you are facing again and again. Maybe you wish you were not facing in this new year. You can hold on, press into it a little while longer. We're going to be all right. In the energy of that, hold on. It's been a lot, and that it's going to be all right. I'm glad to be greeting you, friends, in the new year. And all the questions and prayers I find myself asking in the strange new year, like, how can I live? What is my way forward? And as a pastor, I find myself asking that same question for us as a community, like, what is our way forward? And these questions and prayers, a few things keep coming back to me. They're all versions of something I saw a fellow pastor post on Twitter the other day. They wrote, if we want a good year, we probably can't count on 2022 being good, but we can create goodness in our immediate proximity through prayer, kindness, generosity, and friendship. If we want a good year, we probably can't count on this year being good. That's true every year, really, but we can welcome goodness. We can pay attention to goodness. We can create goodness. This pastor on Twitter listed a lot of ways toward that goodness: prayer, kindness, generosity, friendship, all of which are great. I'm drawn to a slightly different list when in the New Testament we read that in a world where everything falls apart, faith, hope, and love remain. These three things, and the greatest of these is love. Love never fails. We have been unabashed here at Reservoir about the centrality of love in the way of Jesus and of the power of love to uplift and transform every area of our lives and really every corner of this world. 3 years ago, our New Year series was called Training in the Studio of Love. It was a good one, I think. And this year, we begin the year with a series we're calling simply Love Is. And today, we'll think about how love is knowing and being known. Love is about relational knowledge, the process of knowing another and of becoming known by another, to another as well. It's the kind of love I think we need right now. Let's read the two scriptures that will anchor this teaching. First, from the Gospel of John, the Bible's fourth, latest set of stories about the life and teaching of Jesus. It goes like this. The true light that shines on all people was coming into the world. The light was in the world, and the world came into being through the light, but the world didn't recognize the light. The light came to his own people, and his own people didn't welcome him. But those who did welcome him, those who believed in his name, he authorized to become God's children, born not from blood nor from human desire or from passion, but born from God. The word became flesh and made his home among us. We have seen his glory, glory like that of a father's only son, full of grace and truth. This poem calls Jesus three things: word and light and flesh. It's a refashioning of the Bible's very first poem, the story of God, where we hear God spoke, let there be light, and there was light. And God speaks into being then, life after life. Some have read this on the surface as like an account of creation out of nothing that climaxes in this earth and in our species. Others now read it as a living, loving energy, which encouraged that ball of dense matter some 14 billion years ago to explode into ever expanding, ever more beautiful and complex life, you and me included. Word, light, flesh, all a miracle. John is so taken by how Jesus speaks, by his memory of what Jesus reveals, that he reframes this old poem, this story of God poem, to center Jesus. He says, Jesus is the word, the embodiment of God's communicating presence, speaking love and possibility and guidance and truth to all creation. And Jesus is the light, a life force, a truth teller, someone who helps us see better. And then this third word, not just the creator, but the created, that word flesh, human, muscle, blood, brain, heart, sinew, one of us living among us, word and light with a heartbeat. The climax of this poem is that moment. The word became flesh and made his home among us. As the late Eugene Peterson wrote, moved into the neighborhood. The story of God, word and light of God become flesh. Love of God saying to us all, let's be neighbors. We'll come back to this. Our second scripture, it's more mundane. It's just this little bit at the end of the longest letter in the New Testament, the one called Romans. And it goes like this. Timothy, my coworker, says hello to you. And Lucius, Jason, Sosipater, my relatives. I'm Tertius, and I'm writing this letter to you in the Lord. Hello, Gaius, who is host to me and to the whole church, says hello to you too. Erastus, the city treasurer, says hello to you, along with our brother, Quartus. So I got this from a talk on loneliness that Andy Crouch gave a few years ago. At this little list of names, what seems like a footnote is one of the most stunning passages on love and justice and community in the whole Bible. Paul, the writer, sends greetings, as does his partner Timothy, and then some of his relatives. And then there are two really prominent Roman citizens living abroad with Paul. There's Gaius, this Roman-named person, wealthy enough to host a good-sized meeting in his home. On my kids' high school sports teams, you know, back when we had parent gatherings and potlucks and all, the same wealthy parents tended to host them all because they were the people who could fit 50 or more in their home and hire cleaners to spiff up the place and pay for all the wine that 50 parents can drink. That's Gaius here. And Erastus is just like him, another professionally successful, prominent Rome. They send their greetings to the friends in Rome, but so do Tertius and Quartus, whose names literally mean third, fourth. Kids born to families so poor, of such low status, that their kids are merely named for their birth order. Number two, number three, number four. Kids destined to be slaves like their parents were, people of no account in the world. But here they are in the scriptures. Brother Quartus, writer Tertius, getting a pen for the Apostle Paul, some of the most famous words ever written in any language ever, the book of Romans, where brother Tertius gets to say hello, mattering, you know, belonging as much as Paul or the city treasurer or that family with a huge living room or anyone else. I find this so beautiful. Well, there are two things I want to draw out of these New Testament snapshots on love. Two things I want to draw for all of us in this new year. I want us to notice what the love of God is like. And I want to invite us into a very particular way to express beloved community right here in our church over the next two winter months. So first, what is love? Along with many Christians of my generation, I was taught that the love of God has a word, a Greek word, agape. This teaching on agape comes from a long line of Christian teaching that says there are many types of love. There is a storge love, which is familial affection. There is a philia love, like the city of Philadelphia, brotherly and sisterly love between friends. There is eros, erotic love, the sensual romantic love of lovers. And then there is God's love, this teaching says, agape love, the self-giving, self-sacrificial love that seeks the good of the beloved, regardless of feeling or circumstance. That is God's love, we were taught, and that's the model for our love as well. There were related slogans in the 80s, like love isn't a feeling, it's a fact, or love is a decision. Well, there's some truth to this. It is good to keep choosing love, even when we're not feeling it. It's maybe good in certain relationships in particular, but there are a lot of problems with this way of defining love too. I'll name just two of them. One, this, you know, dispassionate, disinterested picture of the love of God. Like, I will seek your highest good for no particular reason other than that's what I do. You know, that doesn't, at least for me, speak to the heart. It doesn't heal to think God may or may not have any particular affection for me or desire for me, but God will seek my good nevertheless. That actually doesn't feel like the greatest of gifts to receive or give a love like that. It doesn't empower great love among people either. For instance, feminists have noted that this kind of teaching, usually by men, encourages women to stay devoted to men who neglect or abuse them. Ignore your feelings, stick with your decision, stand by your man. Religion that empowers abuse is bad religion. Ideas about love that empower abuse are not love. Scholars of love, deep thinkers of love, have shown that all love, including the love of God, is bigger than this. One of those that I read, Roberto Servant, has written about how healthy love has a wider palette. And when he surveys love, he talks about four qualities of love. The first is love as robust concern. A love as robust concern is the parent's longing to see a child have great outcomes in life for no particularly self-interested reason, simply because. This aspect of love is the most similar to Christian teaching on agape. God becomes flesh out of God's robust concern for you and me. The second quality is love as value. Love as value is a parent's longing for the flourishing of a child because the parent sees and believes in the child's worth and special qualities. God becomes flesh because God thinks we are worth it. God values us. Love as union, the third quality of love, is about developing a shared identity. In love, we surrender complete autonomy. Ourselves and our freedom are not lost, but they are limited. They're constrained. It's like a lover desires reciprocity and connection and makes decisions not just for oneself anymore, but for the relationship, the connection, the union. Love as union is a parent's intimate connection with a child as members of a shared family. And love that seeks connection and even reciprocity, it's not a lower form of love, but actually a more invested one. From birth, we're looking for this kind of love. From birth, we are looking for the intimacy of union. We are looking for a face who is looking for us. And God becomes flesh because God wants to be one with us. God's looking for us. God wants to be intimate with us. This too is God's love. And lastly, love as emotion speaks to how those who love are responsive to one another and changed by one another. Love as emotion shows us why happy children make happy parents and vice versa. God becomes flesh because God feels for us, because it makes God feel better when we know that we are loved. The God made flesh in Jesus has all of this, has robust concern for all of creation, you and me included, and is interested in the greatest possible flourishing for all humans and all other life as well. The God made flesh in Jesus highly values the worth of all creation, measuring each of our human lives to be of inestimable worth and finding saving value in other life forms as well. The God made flesh in Jesus seeks intimate connection, even union with all of creation, to through the ongoing participation of God in the life of the world and in our lives, and the God made flesh in Jesus as profound emotional investment in the well-being of human life and the life of the universe as well. All of us matter deeply to God. When we search for God, we are looking for someone who is already looking for us. This is why God moved into the neighborhood. This is how God is saying to us all today, kids, I love you. Let's be neighbors. So the first thing I invite you to do in this new year is to remember every single day that you are loved by God, that you are a beloved child of God, that you are not just loved by a God who seeks your good and who is invested in you, but one who also knows you and wants to be known by you and wants to experience that you are known and deeply loved. We'll practice this a bit at the end of the talk in a few minutes. Secondly, I want to invite you into a particular expression of love in this community, to our own expression of that Romans 16 experience that every one of us matters. Some of us at Reservoir, we're Gaius and Erastus types. We have wealth or big houses or are professionally accomplished. We get told all the time one way or another that we matter in the world. And some of us are more like Tertius or Quartus. We were born to people who didn't believe in our future or into a country or culture that didn't see and validate us. Some of us are poor, some are disabled, some of us are dismissed, disrespected, disregarded by others in any number of ways. And then some of us, frankly, are both, or we're somewhere in between. But none of that tells us how much we matter to God. And none of that tells us how much we matter to one another. And so here's a way I'd love for us to practice that. I learned it from our involvement in the Interfaith Social Justice Collective we're in, which is called GBIO, and it's called a relational meeting. A relational meeting is where two people meet in person, over Zoom, over the phone, it doesn't matter. Two people meet for in between 30 minutes to an hour to simply know part of each other's stories. That's it, no other agenda. Simply for the purpose to matter to one another. It's a one-time thing. There's no obligation to have a follow-up meeting or conversation unless that happens naturally. There is certainly no obligation to become good friends. It's simply a practice of knowing and being known, of forming a wider network of people in your life that you know and care about in some way and who know and care about you in some way. In GBIO, we have these relational meetings a lot because they form networks of people who will show up for one another when we need each other. And in a church, we do this because it makes us more of a church too, a place where we know and are known, where we experience that we all matter. You'll be hearing throughout this month about our community groups, as you did already earlier, which are our primary way of knowing and being known at Reservoir, of having acquaintances, eventually friends here, and having people who can show up for and who will show up for you. I love our groups. But this winter, we are also inviting you to have three one-on-one relational meetings between now and the end of February. Just three. Three conversations with another member of the Reservoir community you don't know well already. Maybe someone you've been acquaintance with for a while, someone you met online or in person at one of our services in a community group. But you'd say to someone else in this community, hey, this church is inviting us to have three relational meetings. Can we have one? Or someone will ask you that. And then here's what you do. Five steps. One, anyone is free to say yes or no. Some of us are more introverted. Some of us are busier. Some of us won't want to participate in this for whatever reason. All that is fine. You can opt out. You don't have to ask anyone. Someone may ask you, hey, can we have a relational meeting? You can say, I'd love to, but I've got a few going already. No awkwardness, totally fine. Two, if you ask someone and they say yes, or if someone asks you and you say yes, set a time and how you're gonna talk, over the phone, over Google Meet, outdoors, on a walk, whatever. Plan on 40 minutes to an hour, no more than that. And then when you have the time, each of you just share a little bit of your story with the other. You can respond and ask questions at all. It is meant to be a natural conversation. But make sure that each of you spend some time sharing a little bit about your story. You can share whatever part of your story you want, but if you're not sure what to talk about, here's the prompt we'll be encouraging you to use this winter: to share something about where you come from, something about where you are today, and something about where you think you're going. These could be very concrete, like where I come from. Let me tell you about the town or city I lived in as a child, or where I am today. Like, here's where I live and what that's like, or where I'm going. Like, here's the place I hope I'll be living, or the job I hope I'll have, or what I hope my life will be like in a few years. Or it could be more abstract. Like, you could share one significant event in your past. You could share something about how you're feeling about some part of your life today, or a dream or a goal you have for your future. Whatever you'd enjoy sharing, where you come from, where you are, where you're going, however it is you'd like to be known. And lastly, then, you just thank each other for your time and for your sharing, and that's it. There's no follow-up. You just keep the conversation to yourselves. It's not meant to be a point of gossip or anything, but that's it. If we each have three conversations like this, so that together we have hundreds and hundreds of them, what will happen is Reservoir as a community will end our winter a stronger, more beloved community. And then lots of us will experience a few more opportunities to know we matter and to convey that to someone else as well. I really invite you to get started today by reaching out to one person you've met in this community and talked to before here, and that you'd like to know or be known by a little more. I'm gonna post about this on our blog this week, these details, and we'll announce it again next week, probably the week after. If you have no idea who to ask, you're kind of new here, or you haven't really met others here, or you don't have numbers to text or emails to contact, if you just don't know how to get started, we're posting a link in the chat now, or we're about to, or maybe we just did, where if you don't know anyone at Reservoir, if you'd like to participate, we'll help you match you with someone else who'd like to have a relational meeting. So you can fill in that form and you'll get a follow-up soon. There is, state the obvious, a lot that's wrong in our world right now, friends. So much. So without any power to predict the future, I can assure you, if we want to have a good year, we probably can't count on 2022 being good, or at least not all of it. Some encouragement this morning is, let's welcome the goodness of God, word and light and love made flesh to us. Love of God, glad to know us, glad to be known, eager for us to know how known we are and how loved we are as well. And let's extend these circles of knowing and being known in this community as well, practicing the loving connection beyond our current circles that has been some of the magic of the people of Jesus for 2 millennia now. We're going to take a minute now to pray together before service continues, to let this soak in a little bit. So here's what I'd love to invite you to do. Wherever you are, if you're willing, if you feel free, just close your eyes, sit comfortably, take a deep breath. We'll spend just a minute or two practicing this encouragement to let settle into you, to let be known to your consciousness how loved you are by our living God. So take another deep breath. I'll welcome the Spirit of God's encouragement. Welcome an awareness of the love of God. Spirit of the living, life-giving God, help us to just taste and see just a little bit how loved we are by you. As you sit there quietly for a minute, imagine that God is present with you. Give yourself permission to welcome God's presence, to imagine that is really so. However it is that you'd like to do that, God is with you right now. And as you do that, as you imagine God right with you in whatever room you're in, imagine too God's word to you, God saying to you, you are my beloved child. I'm so pleased to be with you. God calling you daughter, son, child. God calling you by your name, saying, I love you. I'm so very glad to be with you. Sit there in the awareness, the hope that that's true. One other way in which you could daily experience the love of God, the short four-line creed I like to pray. I've been praying every day this past week and a half. It's written by Dr. Kathy Martin. She's leading an innovative faith community in the Atlanta area. It's just four lines. We say, God matters to me. I matter to me. You matter to me. And we all matter to God. We say, God matters to me. We say, I matter to me, calling to mind our own worth. We say, you matter to me. We might fill in names there. We might fill in beloved people in our lives. Remind us how by name they matter to us. If this church matters to you, you might even say, Reservoir Church matters to me. We call to mind people that matter to you. And then lastly, calling to mind this powerful truth that we all matter to God. I'll say that two more times. You can say with me if you like. God matters to me. I matter to me. You matter to me. And we all matter to God. God matters to me. I matter to me. You matter to me. And we all matter to God. Amen. Before I pass it off, I again encourage you, initiate one relational meeting, one short one-time opportunity to share and to hear someone about talking about where we come from, where we are, where we're going. And I want to remind you one more thing before I pass off and before we continue in prayer today, that if part of how you can experience your mattering to God and your mattering to this community, if you'd like someone to call you up after our service and pray for you, we actually have a prayer team available online again who would love to do that. You email me, steve@reservoirchurch.org before the end of the service. A member of our prayer team will give you a call when the service ends and offer to pray for you over the phone. Simply email me your name and your phone number. That's it. And I'll forward that to our prayer team. They in particular are eager to pray for people having trouble sleeping, people with a significant knee injury, or people you'd like an invitation from God that you too can experience joy, peace, and love. If any of that resonates with you, or you could just use that call of prayer, send me your name and phone number in the next 15, 20 minutes. All right, I'll pass it to Ivy, thanks.
Thanks, Steve. And thanks, prayer team, for being in the wings. In all these ways that we can enter into prayer and into the love of Jesus, we're also going to engage in that now as a community. We'll take a few minutes to pray together. A lot of traditions call this the prayers of the people, but it is where we can become aware of and hold together the longings, the desires, the hopes of each and every one of us, and be reminded that all of those actually help us individually belong to one another. So we'll take a few minutes of silence to get us going in this vein. I'll give you a chance to switch your chat settings to everyone, because I'll be inviting you to sort of name your prayers as we move along. And you're invited to pray with me and also to offer and respond in this prayer, God, hear our prayer, as you'll see. In peace, we pray to you, O God. God, we pray for all people in their daily life and work, for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone. God, hear our prayer. And we pray for this community, our neighborhoods and our cities, and for the world, for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace. God, hear our prayer. And we pray for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble, for the victims of hunger and fear, injustice and oppression. God, hear our prayer. And we pray for the just and proper use of your creation, for peace and unity among all who seek to center their being on the love of Jesus, neighbor, and self. God, hear our prayer. And as you're ready, as you're comfortable, you can start sharing your prayers, and we'll offer them now in time to God. We pray for those among us, Maureen, who's been diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. God, be with her and all those who love her. God, we pray for refugee moms and their babies. God would protect them and meet their needs physically, emotionally, and spiritually. God, we pray for those suffering with hopelessness, addiction, and despair. We pray for friends, Omar's family, as he passed away suddenly this week. God, be close in that grief. May your presence be felt. We pray for honest conversations with those who we love. God, we pray for schools and students and teachers and staff in this landscape of the beginning of this new year. God, we pray for those who suffer with complicated chronic health issues. Be with, break in, and be close. God, we pray for those who are widowed and widowers. And we pray, God, for your resources of joy and for laughter, for loving kindness and candor in what we say and in what we do. Be with healthcare workers, God. Pray with all these students who are experiencing anxiety and depression. Pray for healing in all forms. Pray for grandparents, grandfather who is recovering from a stroke. God, be close. All those suffering from COVID and other illnesses. And for God, pray for these who are making so many choices to be virtual or to be in person in all the spaces and all the places that affects. And God, we pray for all of the prayers that were spoken and all that are unspoken. Amen. We're going to go to a moment in time of communion. So if you have those elements nearby, I invite you to grab them now. On the eve of Jesus's death, he gathered with his closest friends around a table set with familiar elements, and yet a table where Jesus offered new and different and notable words. He took the bread and he took the wine. And as he took the bread, he broke it and he passed it to his friends. And he said, "This is my body broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." And he took the cup of wine and said, "This is my blood, a sign of a new covenant, a new way forward, a new way forward of love. That love is the way." And so in communion, we find an invitation to not only remember, but also as a new way to live with love at the center. a way to give us this embodiment of the word and the light and love in our flesh with a heartbeat. So this morning, I want to give you a moment to let all those prayers that you just heard in our community roll through you, but also maybe to get close to that prayer in yourself, in your heart that might be forming. Take a moment to consider what sustenance or nourishment you might need with Jesus. Maybe it's you need more light or more love or a heartbeat. Why don't you take a moment with Jesus now? Jesus, thank you for being the one who offers us not an idea or a concept of love, but one who offers us the experience and the embodiment of love. Help us to remember this and to help us to live with this. Amen. As you're ready, you can take, I have this little wafer here, you can take the body of Christ, broken and given to you. You can take whatever you have to drink, the blood of Christ, poured out and given to you. All of Jesus poured into us and binding our community in love. Over you, Katie, for our last song of worship.
Thanks, Ivy. Thanks, Steve. Friends, can join me. We'll sing one more song together as part of our time of worship. Thank you.
Would you love us? Would you wrap your arms around us? Would you let us? Would you love us? Would you wrap your arms around us? And Lord, you let us. And Lord, you love us. Lord, you
All right, good to be singing together. Thank you for spending the time too to gather together online. A couple things before I give a final prayer. One final reminder, next week we will only be on YouTube Live. We'll still post the service to YouTube thereafter, but Live will be on YouTube, not on Zoom. If you have questions about that, concerns, you want to know how we'll be using YouTube, whatever, Matt Henderson, our Director of Worship and Arts, he's going to be available in a Zoom gathering in just a few minutes to chat about why we're going on YouTube, what the benefits for you, we believe, in our church will be, try to answer questions, things like that. So one Zoom gathering available just when we wrap up here. If you want to talk about Reservoir on YouTube and how that's going to work, Matt will be there for that. A leader in our community, Ann Bakken, is also hosting just a social, casual get-together, a virtual bagel time. If you're new to Reservoir the past 2 years, you don't know what I'm talking about, but we used to serve bagels in person every single Sunday. I don't know what a virtual bagel time is, how Anne's going to get bagels to you through your internet, but I believe in Anne's power to do so. So there'll be a time to hang out, a virtual bagel hangout, also over Zoom right after this. And so you see those both in your chats. One to talk about Matt, about what the church is up to on YouTube. I'll be on YouTube Live next week. And the other, just hang out with some folks from the church that that Anne is hosting as well. Whether you join in either of those Zooms or somehow try both out or neither at all, hope you have a wonderful Sunday. Let me offer you a closing blessing before we gather together next week. Let's pray. Receive this prayer, receive this blessing, I ask you. May you, my friends, have the power within your spirit to know how beloved you are by God and to know the love of God in Christ that surpasses all knowledge, how high and how wide and how deep and how long is the love of God for you in Christ. Amen. Hey, good to be together. I hope you have a wonderful rest of your Sunday. We'll see you next Sunday at 11 over YouTube. Until then, peace to you. Bye-bye.